Hi, good morning, Arjun. First of all, congratulations on scoring a 750, 98th percentile. How do you feel?
It's absolutely fantastic.
Got it. So you scored a Q50 and a V40. So again, a very well-balanced score in terms of whenever you do apply, a lot of schools actually look at a well-balanced score as well. So again, kudos to really doing well on both sections, right? What was the secret ingredient of your success to doing well on both sections, not just really one section?
So I think the secret ingredient is time and structure. I think initially I was thinking that I can get it done quite quickly. When I'll walk through my entire journey of this, then I can probably highlight it better. But I was anticipating a quicker win rather than a stretched out win. And I was hoping to get it done with a brute force approach, which is like, these are the topics that are weak. Get it done. Do more questions and get it done out of your way. So initial strategy was quite misaligned, but the secret ingredient is the time and the structure. I think it doesn't matter how else you work about it.
I think that's a very valuable point, and you mentioned brute force approach, and we will talk about that later as well, right? Because a lot of students eventually just look at a topic, think it's weak, and then practice hundreds of questions and think they'll master it. Doesn't work, obviously. So let's talk about your GMAT prep. How did you begin preparing for the GMAT? What got you to really preparing for the GMAT?
Sure. So I have to apply this year, which is the September deadline, round one deadlines. So I was hoping to get this GMAT thing done before January. Initially, I thought that I'll get it done last year, which is 2020. But then I started preparing a little bit, and then suddenly COVID hit. So all the centers were closed, and there was no GMAT online. So I postponed that, and I started working on my own startup and the job. So then I didn't have much time. But then I suddenly realized that this online option was much more efficient now. Initially, they had that whiteboard, online whiteboard issue, which I think is not a right approach for me because I'm much more of a hands-on person. But then they shifted to a physical whiteboard. So I thought that I can get it done with a physical whiteboard. So once I realized that and I started reading stories of people who were comfortable giving online GMAT, I said, might as well. So I started to prepare in November. But essentially, I had a full-time job. I still have a full-time job, so the time commitment was not there. So quant, since I come from an engineering background, I was quite certain that quant is something I'll get it done. It'll come more from the questions rather than going about into a theory. Verbal, I was hesitant about, but I had good command on my spoken English, but which I later realized is quite different from your technical English or putting commas and understanding was still a meaning there. Like, there's still a meaning with ing modifiers, something like that. So I never used to put quite an emphasis on that kind of English, but I knew I could get it done quickly. So November, I was just going through all the rules, going through some questions. But then I started like 25th of November. I realized that I need to get it done right away. So I allocated 10 days of free time for me, which is not too much office work, not too much startup work, only core GMAT study. And then I had a date for 5th of December for that right after study. But then I gave my mock on 1st of December, and I suddenly realized that okay, I'm not standing up in the
And
verbal
how much did you
section. And
score
then
in that
I
mock?
that mock I was scoring around 700 and 700, 700, 710. It was
710,
averaging
I
around
think.
that.
Yeah, 700. It was, yeah. I think you took the mock on 6th of December and you scored a 700.
So I have always been someone who never used to like tests, but nonetheless, I used to excel at it because I knew I had to get it done. But I never used to go about a test from purely learning perspective. So I was never that 100% scorer. I was always at 95, 94, who used to get the job done, but not that too interested into the subject. Until unless it's a really interesting subject, I never used to get into it to get the full understanding of it. But then I realized that I have less amount of time. And after January 2021, I had other time commitments. And there were certain projects at my my full-time job as well, which were really going to be time intensive, and I realized that I would definitely not get any time set apart time for application process, which also needs to be done before September. So then I said, might as well go about a course. And then I Googled and figured out that GMAT Club, you guys were the most reviewed and well taken to course structure.
I'll just stop you here. So a lot of people say that, you know, we have the most number of reviews, and we do. We have like 2016 reviews right now, which is insane. It's an insanely high number. Do you think there's value to that number?
Yeah, definitely, because at the end of the day, advertising is a game that is being played by all the courses providers, right? But these kind of reviews and in this quantity cannot come from a monetary driven advertisement. Until unless a person is really really satisfied with the service, I think the sheer quantity of these reviews is not something that can be a common, like,
they have to be organic.
They have to be organic. They can't be inorganic. Yeah, you correctly put it.
So I mean, I think that's a very good point that you make. And so you plan to give the GMAT on the 5th of December. You ultimately have taken the GMAT, I think, 19th, 20th of Jan. I think huge shout out to you in terms of the fact that you have the foresight to plan once. So you know that you're going to take 3-4 months for your application process. You know that you're going to have intensive projects going forward after Jan. So it's very, very important that you kind of finish off with it. And you kind of have that determination to finish off with it. A lot of people don't follow through with it. And they just kind of, you know, they stray off their path. I think that's a very, very big deal, right? Now, let's get back to the part where you read about us on GMAT Lab. What was the defining factor that really pulled you to the entire GMAT online course?
Apart from the reviews, I actually went to YouTube and searched for your free courses. So I really liked your meaning-based approach, which is not something that I was following because I was starting from Kaplan. I was eliminating options based on vertical splits and then choosing the options from them. Vertical split works, but at the end of the day, it just leaves you with like 2 or 3 tricky options, which are not something you can eliminate with vertical split or something like that.
Yeah, a lot of other prep companies do the vertical split approach as well. I know of 2-3 myself. And if you give the GMAT, you know that the last 2-3 options are the most ambiguous. You'll absolutely not be able to find any errors in those little statements, and you'll keep reading them again and again and again. Take away time from a CR and RC question and then end up with nothing. So I think that's fair. That's fair.
That was definitely my issue. because the other thing is that when I was initially giving the GMAT, initially giving the mocks, so to speak, so I was thinking the timing is my issue. It's not timing, it's just that the method that I was applying, it took longer amount of time just because the method was not correct. So it can be as simple as, see, there are multiple ways to solve a question, right? But if someone has timed that question, then there's a specific short-term method to reach it in a quicker way. So you can definitely solve the question in like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, but you have to solve it under 1.5 minutes. So that has to be done with a structured approach. And I think that doesn't come from vertical.
So the meaning-based approach essentially helps you reduce time and essay, not increase it, right? Yeah, I think a lot of people find meaning-based approach a little difficult in the beginning. They take a little longer and then they say, wait, this is taking way longer than the elimination approach. And maybe this is not for me. And then they kind of, you know, go back to their old ways. And again, that never works because essentially the meaning-based approach is the only thing that can really get you past an SC on the GMAT. So you saw the free content, you saw the free material. What happened after that? Arjun can't hear you a lot. It's a little faint. I think you just have to come a little closer.
So it was about timing for me as well. So I knew that within 1-1.5 month, I need to be done with this because I have other things to take care of. So once I did that, I realized ki might as well go with the structured approach. You guys were much more reviewed, much more well taken to by the community and in the GMAT club. So I said there should be something substantial out of this. So and apart from that, you guys were running I think a promotional offer. So I got you guys like for $350, something like that, which is even if it's not a promotional offer, it's fine. But again, so that promotional offer like was the tipping point. So
No,
I
price point is
really
important there. Price point, especially for the Indian market, is important because everybody in India wants the best bang for buck. That's how we are built, right? We're built to really take as much as we can from whatever we're investing in, and that's a good thing, and that's a really, really good thing as well. So, how did you go about doing the course? What was your first step, and how did you manage, applying yourself in the course?
Once I went to the course, essentially when I started with the course, you guys have this training tutorials, videos like do this, do this, do this, do some intake quizzes, and then customize quizzes. And once you do a topic, do make sure to do the cementing quiz so that it solidifies the concept, and then in the long run, you don't forget that concept and you are comfortable applying that concept. So I did that. I went through SC topic by topic, and then I was cementing the I did a lot of cementing quizzes. I did not do 100% of all the cementing quizzes because I mentioned at the very beginning I'm not that 100% kind of guy. I just get the job done. So I skimmed a lot, which is not the right way to go about it, but nonetheless I skimmed a lot, which I later recognized was the problem, and I went back and got it done completely.
Yeah,
But
so we had this very interesting conversation where, I reached out to you after you had taken the mock, and I think CR specifically, strengthen and weaken, I figured that there's a problem there. Even though you were good at it, I think you hadn't really done the course over there, right? And that's where I could tell you that, listen, go and do the course, please just do it and then see the difference. How much of a value addition was it to actually just figure out what your weakness was from the call? And then actually go and do that. Did it really matter as you moved on into the course?
yeah, that was definitely a very, very crucial step in my preparation, because identifying your issues and then going about figuring out how to fix it is the main problem, main work that needs to be done, right? Once you've identified it, if you don't take the correct approach, you're not going to get it done. If you don't identify it, even if you're taking the right approach, you're still doing it too broad, you can't do it, get it done. So there needs to be both the things need to be balanced. So you need to figure it out and then put in a structured way to get it. So I think this identification approach was definitely helpful for me. Because in CR, once I got it done, then RC was something that I didn't do at all. Because RC, I figured, was a bigger CR. I think a lot of people felt similarly. And I googled a lot, and I didn't have much time, so I said do CR thoroughly, do a lot of questions for CR, figure out the patterns, and RC will fit in. But then RC was again a problem, a little bit of problem for me, but I've always been an avid reader, so reading is not that of an
And
issue
here's
for
the
me.
thing,
I
right?
think it
So if a person like you, who's an avid reader, is actually saying that RC was a problem at a point, or CR was a problem, that basically shows that even if you're really good with comprehension as a non-native, even when I was given the GMAT, I had the same thing, that I'm really good with my English. Like, there's no way in hell that I'm gonna do badly. But it's completely different. I mean, you speaking well, reading a lot, and calling yourself an intellectual is very different than doing well on this exam. It's absolutely poles apart. So I think there's a lot of value in what you're saying, that structured approach and that time constraint of really getting those things done and learning from them to do well on the GMAT, even if you're really good with your English. I think that does matter. So anything else that you remember from the call that we did that you took away, that was helpful to you?
So yeah, from the calls again, my approach was thoroughly brute force. So I have always been that hammer on the iron kind of guy. Keep on hitting it until you get the job done, and most of the time it gets the job done. But this is because when you are hitting it in that way, you're thoroughly relying on your intellectual capabilities. which I later realized is not how this exam works. This exam is at the end of the day not a reflection of your intellectual capabilities, rather than it's about timing and structure. Anyone who is like who has a lower IQ can score higher than you, and anyone who's higher who has a higher IQ can score lower. So it's definitely not a, at least that's my opinion. I might be wrong,
No, very
but
well said. Absolutely right. And that's the whole point. It's not about your IQ, it's just about how you go about studying and hitting the right areas and doing it the right way. I think, having said that, the brute force approach does work for a lot of people in a certain way, right? I mean, there's a certain percentage of students that kind of do well from that approach just because of their innate abilities. And I think there's a lot of value in that as well. So yeah, post the call, I created that, plan for you. Now I want to ask you, and be completely honest, did you follow all of the plan? Did you follow some of the plan? How did you go about doing the plan?
so yeah, as you mentioned at the very beginning of the call, I didn't do everything like to the mark, right? So, but I realized that there is value in this entire email, which you need to derive as much as you possibly can, because this is like a red team for me, which is essentially a third person's perspective on what I'm doing wrong. So either you can ignore this, or you can actually derive some sort of a value which will essentially push you to a better score. So initially, I was hesitant to go about. I have always been hesitant to third party reviews, which has been my problem, so to speak, and my strength, because not every time third party review is right. You need to rely on your
Confident in
instincts
your own
sometimes.
abilities as well, and that's fair, right? And that's exactly the point that I wanted to make, that we have a certain approach. We have this three-stage approach. Now, everybody does not apply it 100%, but the idea is there. The idea is that you work on the areas that you need to work on, you cement them, then you're test ready, take those kinds of quizzes. Now, you may not have gone through all of the kinds of steps that I wanted you to go through, but you did it in your own way. And that worked for you. And that shows that even if you kind of follow this process partially, that improves your chances of success. I think that is the true indicator here, right? Now let's
So
talk about, yeah.
my timing issue was resolved because of that test readiness, right? Because at the end of the day, there was a time when I was good at SC, CR, and RC, all of them, but I could complete only 31 questions, 32 questions. I was like, this is problematic for me. I just need to reduce my SC time and boost my CR accuracy, and RC, I need to give more focus. What that was all boiling down to was time. Because if you don't have time, which you currently recognize, I think, at the very first meeting, is that I don't have time. Because I was doing one, two, and three sections. You guys spread it into four
Yeah,
time
blocks.
analysis. I
Yeah.
was doing fine in one, two, and three. Fourth, I had like one fourth or half of the time that I was allocating to one, two, and three. So it didn't actually make sense because I was hurrying through. I couldn't actually get the full understanding of it. And that timing issue was pulling my down, score down at the very end. But once I got it right in the initial few slabs of the test, then you get adequate amount of time to get the later harder questions right. And through this test readiness, I think there was a lot of time reduction that was going on, which I later realized helped me, which further boosts your confidence at the end of the day. And if you have time and confidence, I think you can get it done. So
That's true. I think test readiness, a lot of people don't realize it reduces time eventually. It's very gradual. Like if I tell you to take two test readiness quizzes, you want to flunk at them in the first two quizzes, because you're anyways not doing it properly. You don't know when to let go of a question. You don't know how to really manage your time across the test. So obviously you'll flunk it. But that's the idea, right? That to build upon that kind of confidence from one test to another. And I think that's what it kind of eventually helps you on the test. And one more thing I think that's really important is finishing strong. So it's very important to finish strong on the GMAT. A lot of people kind of think the opposite way, that it's very important to kind of focus on the first 15, 20 questions. Not true. You've got to finish strong. And that's what really gets you a V40. That's exactly why you're sitting on a V40, because you're able to finish strong now, because I'm sure that you had enough time on the test towards the end now that you kind of practiced all of that. Let's talk about your mocks, right? Let's talk about the scores that you were getting on your mocks, official mocks, Sigma X mocks. So just take me through your mock strategy.
So the mock strategy was simple because I had read a lot of reviews online where people were blatantly taking a lot of mocks that didn't work. People were putting too much time between their mocks that didn't work either. So I had to find a sweet spot for me. And since I had less amount of time, I think that I figured out my sweet spot. So it was like 3-4 days work, figure out your issues, correct them, and then go for a mock. Which is essentially one of these, which is essentially similar to exactly similar to what you also proposed in your plan. So it was like this, but initially my scores were, they were low because Sigma X mocks, they actually reflect the capabilities, which was not that strong at this initial onset of this entire journey. So I was scoring in 710, 720, 730, something like these. So once I had scored like V43s, and then I was stuck at V39 and V40. So I was like, once I got V43, I can get it again. Might as well try again and again, which didn't work. But before giving my last Sigma X mock, I gave my official mock. On that, I scored 770. So I was like, hey, it's fine. And then I gave my Sigma X mock and I got a 690. I'm like, oh my God, there's too much of a fluctuation. Even if I average it out, this is not the kind of score that I want. So I was thoroughly bummed out after that 690. So I gave myself one day to follow, and then the next day I said I'll take it again. Might as well be there. There might be certain external circumstances which might be impacting my score. So I gave another mock. I got 760 on official mock. So it's like, okay, I'm ready for the exam. And then
right.
Before the 19th exam, I gave one more mock. I got a 770 on that.
Got
so.
And you reached out to me when you scored a 690 as part of the
yeah.
plan, and you were asking me, should I even give the GMAT? Is it the right thing to do? What was there in that video analysis that I shared with you?
Yeah, you definitely said that it's a stumble, don't worry about it. You don't have to push your date that much. You can definitely get the job done with the current preparation. But again, at the very beginning, I mentioned that I have like too many doubts in third party opinion, right? And I was looking at the score, and then I was like, no problem, let's average it out. Like 770, 690, what's the average? 730, not the score you want.
Yeah.
And like, don't worry about it, so give it again. So and then I gave again an official mock, scored 760. Then again, I gave 770. So I was like averaging 2760. On official mocks, I was averaging like 765, 770, 760, 770. So I was like, okay, I'll score better than this on the final exam. So, and then I gave my final exam, and then I got like 750, which is an average of what Sigma X was saying and what.
So I think you kind of hit the sweet spot with your mock strategy as well. And that was a pretty cool thing that you're, having said all of this now, You mentioned that you don't trust third party opinions. Do you trust third party opinions now?
Yeah, they definitely help. So you need to be able to recognize value whenever it's offered. So it's not always the case that you will recognize 100% of the value that's been given, which is definitely the case with me. I always rely. I'm always like not very sure of third party opinions, but nonetheless, there was definitely value which was offered to me and which I later realized and took in and worked with it, and that definitely helped me.
So now that you scored a 750, where do you go from here? You're planning to apply to what schools? And you must be planning to apply in the early application round, right? For most schools.
Yeah. First round of schools I'll apply. I'll be applying to Wharton, Stanford, Sloan, Chicago, Columbia, and NCR as well. Rotman as well. So I have a close to list of 10 schools. They're like top 20 schools. I'll try and aim for them. But if not, then I'll add more schools to it.
Yeah. So I think there requires to be that kind of structured approach and refining the number of schools you want to apply to, because after all, at the end of the day, one application costs you about anything between $250. A lot of money to pay if you're applying to 10 schools. That's $2,500, which is around 2.5 lakhs. It's a lot of money, trust me. So the idea is to have three kind of tiers, totally apply to. I'm sure you know this. Your REIT schools, the schools that you kind of know that you're going to get into, most probably with like 80% hit rate. And then there are the third-tier schools where you know you will get in with a scholarship, right? So I think the scholarship question also comes into play for you, given that you have such a great score. But applying to M7 business schools, engineer cohort, I think you're going to have a lot of competition, even at a 750. Think you would know that. So it's really important to kind of have that application in place. But you have enough time to get that application in place now. So you have a seriously good chance at making it in these schools. Also, once again, Arjun, thank you so much for your It was a lot of fun, and I hope that we have made you a believer now.
Definitely a believer.
Okay, thanks again,
Thank you,
Arjun.
Ranjay.
I really appreciate it. This was a lot of fun. Thank you.